Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mga. We are discussing the proposed new A-level curriculum that is under, you know, proposal by the National Curriculum Development Center. With me in studios are two distinguished guests from the NCDC, and that's Tadeo Wambare, the Communications and Public Relations Officer, and also Bonaventure Biaruhanga is a curriculum specialist from NCDC. Gentlemen, before we leave for a break, I wanted to understand, because when Biaruhanga is talking about having two principal subjects that will be useful in your career, who should determine the career of a student, and how do you determine that this child doesn't need economics or doesn't need history or doesn't need geography? How do you determine that this person is supposed to be going at a particular career, and who should do that?
I think, like they say, it takes a village to raise a child. Mm. So it's the effort of different stakeholders, but starting from the home, the parent, and also as the child grows,
yes,
they themselves, their passion, their interests should determine what they become in life.
Mm.
And then along the way, they are nurtured by their teachers and other caregivers.
Mm.
Who actually spend a little more time with them in the present circumstances. So it's a decision that involves so many other players.
From the statistics that we have received from different institutions, shows that over 35% of labor productivity in Uganda is related to lack of skills and the behavior of the labor that we have, the human resource that we have in our country, stems from the weaknesses they find in those classes where they teach these students. How are we sure that under this new curriculum, we're not likely to find these kind of weaknesses?
Okay, thank you, the presenter. Actually, that one was very, very loud in the market survey.
Mm-hmm.
The employers were telling us that, you know, the people come with good grades, but they cannot work together in teams.
Mm-hmm.
They cannot do something new. They are,
yes,
not creative. They cannot communicate. They are not innovative at all. Every other thing, you know, they are highly academic without an applicability. So that one informs the creation and the rearrangement of the content.
Mm.
You see, Mr. Presenter, what we have today is a class where teachers go to class as early as 4 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
and they teach the learners up to 10 p.m. from 4 a.m. in some cases. Some classes are beginning at 4 a.m. in the morning, mm-hmm, and ending as late as 10 p.m. And then those learners are only receiving knowledge from the expert teacher,
mm,
who is giving them what will come in the examination. They are not allowed to have any time to express themselves. They are not allowed to have any time to even exercise their bodies. So this is the same thing that is transferred in the world of work. Even if such a person completes and they go to work, they find it very hard to adjust,
mm,
to work in groups, because this side they were told this is the standard, this is what will come in the examination.
Mm.
Therefore, their thinking is locked, if I were to use that word. Their thinking is locked. So even when they go to work, they begin thinking that somebody must always feed them with what to do and so forth and so forth and so forth. So their creativity, their critical thinking,
mm,
is really hampered so much during this education.
Isn't that a weakness,
yes,
of the universities and not A-level, for
even
example?
The A-level itself. Even, mm, the A-level itself. Because even the A-level, that's what we are, the way we are teaching. So at the end of the day, you know, these things, all these skills are learned as you grow up.
Mm.
If you did not learn how to communicate as you grew up, it becomes hard that you will have one day come and sit in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us, it becomes hard to adjust. So we need to change that, even at A level, like we have done for O level.
Mm-hmm.
Learners begin having some small group discussions, having some small projects where they can showcase their creativity, and this is what we want to transfer even to the A level.
Are you, in other words, saying that all the problems that we are having with that poor human resource stems from A level and not any other level of education? But that actually has been, you know, somehow explained. I just want to pick your view on the time. How did you arrive at saying we need two principal subjects instead of arriving at a conclusion and say the 2 years are too much. Let's reduce it to 1 year and say A level in Uganda is 1 year, only a senior five, somebody sits an examination. Reduce the time instead of reducing the subjects or the principal subjects.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. Well, maybe there could be countries which are doing it that way. But one thing about curriculum changes is that it is usually very difficult for you to make so many big changes at once. It shocks the system. Because already we are trying to see if the two principles can work, and then learners are exposed to very many aspects of these two principal passes, which lead them into their careers. And like you had said, who chooses the career? First, the interest of the learner must be at the forefront. Before the school say that for you are medicine, for you are what, you are lawyer or what, the interest of the learner is very, very important. At times, some of our schools are forcing people to change these combinations and so forth. But the learner says that for me, even if I were to finish and I first do a diploma and then I will do a degree later, I don't mind. But for you, are saying I want only those of you who can get A, and you go directly to these courses. So the interest of the learner is very, very, very important in choosing these careers. So back to your question of why not
why reducing the subject and not reducing the time? Because certainly you've been talking about students being taught from 4 a.m. to 4 to 10 p.m. So reduce the time, and certainly these issues will be addressed rather than reducing the subject.
Okay, that would be one of the proposals. But incidentally, it didn't seem to come out from the different stakeholder engagements that the time should be reduced. Yes. Because the reducing the time brings in an aspect of toning down or cutting down the content, even even the remaining subjects, whether two or three. Now, cutting down the content brings an aspect of saying that how prepared will these ones be, especially those who are going to continue with higher education. So that idea of reducing the time, if we can see that the subjects can be reduced and it works, I want to say that normally these issues of curriculum change may not be an event. They have to be gradual.
Yes.
When maybe some of the things have worked and adjusted, then you think about other proposals. Because different countries, Japan, Malaysia, whatever,
have different experiences.
And they have gone through these changes for over 50 years.
Yes. I want to come back to you, but after Tadeo. Tadeo, you are proposing a new curriculum, but this may have an impact onto the teachers and the system. As is saying, it may as well shock the system. How are you prepared to make sure that actually the teachers comply to this new proposed curriculum?
Thank you. I think once all the consultations have been made and the new curriculum comes into force, there will be an element of training of teachers. We do orient them on the new curriculum. But there is also a whole directorate under Ministry of Education and Sports, our parent, that does the teacher training part. So we work together with them to provide training and then also do support, supervision. We also do refresher programs with the teachers. So it's part of
The process.
Yeah.
But I just don't understand, because if Biarhanga is talking about, for example, a history teacher who's supposed to teach a course, for example, a subject that involves some kind of economics, that sounds like you want to take back teachers to classes and teach them economics. Because I don't understand how you're going to do that, Biarhanga.
There are two career subjects. If I'm a history teacher, if I'm a physics teacher, I remain in the physics subject. Mm-hmm. But then we have the interdisciplinary, which can be supported by the different teachers in the school, because all of these teachers exist in the schools.
What are those subjects?
Interdisciplinary. This one combines very many aspects of society, like I've said. Ethics, economics, environment, health awareness, basic ICT, for example. The content is going to be built along all of those cross-cutting issues, which are not hinged on a particular subject.
Yes.
And we encourage schools to begin tapping into their resource to support them. But also, Mr. Presenter, remember that, for example, when we started the subjects like ICT a few years back, we didn't have teachers who were specifically prepared for teaching this ICT. And we started training those who were within the system. Math teachers, history teachers, started doing the basics, and then they transformed from their former career teaching subjects to ICT. And now we have reached somewhere. But if we had waited to have teachers for ICT specifically trained, maybe by now we wouldn't have started. So this interdisciplinary, the teachers exist. Like the GP, teachers have been existing, only that it was sort of more of language. But we want to make it richer so that whoever is from either combinations.
So in other words, you're going to make an addition in the subjects, not reducing or removing some of the concepts or some of the topics and subjects of discussion or teaching. In the, for example, we have been seeing people complaining that people are taught things are actually which are out of touch from the reality. You're having people teaching people geography, Canadian prairies. You had people talking about French revolutions. So how are we likely to have these ones remaining in the curriculum, or we are likely to have a comprehensive change of the face of these subjects?
Well, some of them will remain for their significance in the society. Some of them will definitely be removed. In the curriculum work, we have what we call obsolete information, that which is no longer useful. That is which that information which we see that is only for the past, is not progressive. And remember, we are talking about preparing people for the 21st century skills. So why should we keep on teaching them, preparing for them for a world that will never exist again? So definitely, there will be some reorganization, even within the content of the career subject themselves. There are things that we no longer need so much.
Yes.
Look at this, for example, modern trends in business. You can transact business online, for example. Our education books at OLEV and A-level, if I'm not mistaken, don't have anything to deal with online business.
Yes.
What we still have is the ledger, you feel cash in, cash out, what. But the people you are teaching, We'll never do the cash books
and whatever.
They may not. They will only go in into the ATM and they make they change their balance and whatever, and computerize the systems of doing business. So why, for example, would we keep on teaching people some of the information that we know is no longer going to be of use? Even starting from the primary, by the way, these reforms, we started with thematic at the primary, then you have the O level. I think you had that question previously. Why not? So we started with thematic, of course, with challenges. Curriculum work, there will be so many people to question you.
We are going to talk about the challenges later, but I was reading a lot of comments coming in from the public, the section of the public, and some of them were saying, one of the benefits, actually, I want to put this question to Tadeo, one of the benefits that experts are saying that this new curriculum is going to equip dropouts. Seems like you are encouraging people to drop out before going to universities. How about that, Tadeo?
Thank you. I think it's based on reality. If you look at the number of people who join school from maybe up right from pre-primary up to university, there are so many who drop out along the way. From P1 up to P7, there's quite a huge number. So
that
from
drops out.
P1, from P7 to senior 4, at that stage there's also a number that drops down as you go up. So you have to cater for those as well, because they are going out there. They need to survive and they need to be productive for the country to achieve its objectives.
Okay.
So in all the plans you have, you must endeavor to cater for that group as well. It's a reality.
Would you actually have a comment on that? Because it seems like you are encouraging people after going to A-level, they already have the skills they need, there is no relevancy and need to go to the universities, which are quite actually becoming very expensive in our country.
So, okay, thank you. He has said it. We don't only prepare people to go to the university. I think that's where we get it wrong. There are definitely those who will not go to the university directly. Those who will go to the university are encouraged to also be prepared. That's why we have not dropped the career subjects. They remain there. But the issue of the skills is that how do we benefit. Even those of us who have completed university, we can also we keep on talking about skills. Many of us want to sit only in offices. Why would it be that somebody has to finish university and then they go to be doing skilling? You have these programs, which are good, Skilling Uganda, because that means that there is a gap.
There is a need.
Why should I first finish university, then I go to begin learning, tailoring, for example? Then why did I finish? Why did I take all these years in the university in the first place? Yes, if you can combine the vocational, the skilling, as you go up, then it becomes support to you. Because like you talked about the 1952 report and so forth, the education then was preparing a small minority to occupy some few
public offices and jobs. Yes,
these days they may not be,
because in the mind of Bunsen, they were looking at the prevailing need at the time.
Yes,
but now things have changed.
Yeah, the need, it's no longer an issue of saying that when for us I was in O level in 1995, when you got first grade, the whole sub county would know.
Yes,
these days it's no longer the case. So it means that there is something that has to change. The need has changed.
How does this actually also demystify the power of an examination? Are you in any way proposing assessment? Because we've been hearing assessment-based teaching and studying in schools. How does this new curriculum incorporate that component?
Yes, very good. First of all, assessment, to many of the years, assessment has been changed to mean examinations.
Yes.
Which is actually not the case. Examination is just one component of the assessment. So we propose, which has also started from Oregon, that school assessments contribute to the end of cycle assessment. But if in case somebody may not have completed the cycle, for example, whereas they have no certificate, but at least you are able to go to the schools and you have an exit profile, and somebody can tell you that, yes, I know he didn't complete senior six, but during his stay here, he was able to do A, B, C, D. And that in itself is very important. And if you have been certified by our neighbor here, DIT, then it gives you a recognition that maybe if I may not have to employ somebody with a degree or a diploma, but I want to employ somebody who can work on my chicken farm and has competence in that, has been assessed by a competent body like DIT, then it is important, then we can look through. Because during their stay at school, although they didn't complete, they were able to exhibit that they have these competences in poultry rearing. Yes, we don't want to say that. We want to encourage people to drop out. But also, like we have said, every one of us, whether you complete and reach the highest level of education or you don't, you are needed in the development of this country.
Tadeu, have we reached a point where this country, I think, is now having many graduates that are required, now that you are putting much emphasis in A-level, so that you don't find any need to go to a university in the future?
Thank you. I think we, over time, given the prevailing conditions, many institutions have come up, which is good. We have so many knowledge centers now.
Yes.
And but like my colleague said, there is a shift in the world of work. Employers are looking more. They're looking out for skills. They want to see
papers.
What you can do, not what you know. So as a result, I think it has created a gap. And as a result, a reflection is required to ensure that we have both the knowledge and also the skills to fulfill the country's vision.
Biaruhanga, one of the experts I was reading was talking about that this curriculum, highlighting on the challenges that it may actually bring out, is that the quality of students we have these days is not as the quality that we used to have in the past. And thereby you have to create very easy content and very easy subjects for them to be able to pass. You are making it easy for the students to pass even when they are not supposed to pass.
Yeah, from an academic point of view, that one would be correct. But all the learners, I don't know, some of the people who may be saying that, I don't know whether they have looked through the content, for example, for the O-level, to see that there is something that is just easy for people to go through. But that's not the situation, for example. Mm. Even in any learning situation, it's not about hardiness, because we have different categories of the learners in these classrooms. That's a known fact psychologically. Mm. We don't all achieve at the same level, and we need to take care of all of this. It's not only very good to say that, okay, even if it were to be 80% who have passed and 20 who have failed, sorry, that 20 is also still important. Mm. Why did they go to school? So it's not an issue of saying that this has to be easy and this has to be difficult, but the way we teach them. Because some of these people who say that the content has become easier are the same people who say that students are finishing senior six with very good grades, with A, they go to university, they go into those very upper tier professions, and the first semester they have a chain of retakes, the second semester they are running away. So that means that the grades,
We are lying.
There's something that
the reality was
different. The reality is different.
We have to wind up this whole conversation. Tadeu, I want actually also to, you know, tell us what exactly is this curriculum? What is the state of this curriculum? Which stage is it? And when are we expecting it to be rolled out in the schools and the teachers get to teach the students?
Thank you. The needs assessment was done, I think, which is usually the first stage. And a report was produced. Later on, consultations, or initial consultations were held, and consultations are still ongoing. So there are a number of processes within the center itself, and after that, there will be an upward engagement with the Minister of Education and Sports.
Yes.
And again, other players.
Are we looking at a timeline? A timeline of some sort?
Yes. Because, like I said, it's a chain. Mm. So we expect that learners who are completing their cycle in 2024, the pioneers of the O level curriculum, should actually find
a new curriculum.
Mm. At the end of their cycle. Absolutely. So that it's a continuation.
So we are looking at 2025.
Yes.
It will be like in schools.
Yes.
Your last word, Biarhanga, I just want actually also to know, was this curriculum benchmarked anywhere? Are you just looking at things and you just created your own imagination and say we need this new curriculum, or you benchmarked it somewhere?
Okay, we have not rolled it out, so I wouldn't say we have benchmarked it. Like he has said, we have a timeline, and this timeline we shall have done all these other processes, including benchmarking from other practices in different societies, in different countries, including also trying to try out what we shall have prepared. So far we have started on the needs assessment, and then we are beginning on the consultation, and then we shall benchmark. Definitely a curriculum is both supposed to satisfy the needs of this society, but also looking at international aspirations, because we are preparing a global
community.
Global community.
Yes, and do you have the money, by the way, to do this?
Oh, that's a very interesting one. We get money from government, and therefore the success of these processes definitely depends on the goodwill of the government to support. But government has already supported the successful rollout of the O level up to this level, including all these other processes. So why not?
All right. Gentlemen, thank you so much. We've been discussing the new proposed curriculum of the A level standard of education, and that every student is required to offer two principal subjects if we are to go by the proposal. And we've been looking at the impact and what is likely to be the impact of this new A-level curriculum. We've been having Tadeu Wambale, is the Communications and Public Relations Officer at the National Curriculum Development Center, and Mr. Bonaventure Biarhanga, the Curriculum Specialist. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me this morning. We are going to take a very short break. When we return, Rush Talk comes with much more that is happening in the entertainment industry.